Hello everyone, this is me Garima Singh. Today I will talk about Thami, that is Pisan, Zamindar and the state. So here we talk about subsistence agriculture, what type of agriculture activity happened in those period of time, that is 16th and 17th century. Then we will discuss about role played by women in agriculture production, what role does women play at that time. We will discuss about transactions, monetary transaction, what being done at that time. We will talk about Mughal fiscal system. Then we will talk about economic relation in agrarian societies, social influence, forest dwellers of 16th and 17th century. Then we'll talk about Zamindar in Mughal India. Then discuss about a village society, village agriculture of that period of time. So there's a lot of things to discuss in this chapter. So as I have said, my history strategy is different. I'm just discussing the solution because more or less it's same kind of thing, going through crux and discussing solution, because question include all what are the topics have been covered in this chapter. So let's move on to the question discussion directly. It should be on 27th, I hope. I'm making it a bit larger so that can be visible to you. Let's move on to the questions. First is, what are the problem in using the iron as a source for reconstructing agrarian history? How do historians deal with the situation? So here is Ayn Akbari, the book. The Ayn Akbari, written by Abu Fazal in 1598, contained invaluable information for reconstructing the agrarian history of the Mughal, but it has its own limitation. That is, numerous error in totaling have been deducted. There are, however, minor and do not detract from overall quantitative accuracy of the manual. That another limitation is the skewed nature of data. Data was not collected uniformly from all provinces. For example, Abu Fazal has not given any description regarding the caste composition of Zamindar of Bihar, Bengal, Odisha. It's Bengal and Odisha. Then the physical data collected from various sources is in detail, yet some important parameters such as wages and prices have not been incorporated properly. Then the detailed list of prices and wages found in the Ayn Akbari have been acquired from data pertaining to the capital Agra and its surrounding region. It is therefore of limited value for the rest of the empire. Then historians have dealt with the situation by supplementing the account of Aine by information got from province. These included detailed 17th, 18th century revenue record from Gujarat, Rajasthan and Maharashtra. So these have been also supplemented by a record of the East India Company. Next is, to what extent is it possible to characterize agriculture production in the 16th, 17th century as subsistence agriculture? Give reason for your answer. So during Mughal, India was basically an agriculture country. In the Mughal state of India, different variety of crop were produced. In Bengal, two variety of rices were produced, but not the focus of the cultivation of basic crop. So basic crop does not mean that only subsistence agriculture exists in medieval India. Then the Mughal state encouraged peasants to cultivate variety of crop which brought in revenue, especially cotton and sugarcane. Then cotton was mainly grown in vast area which was spread across over central India and the Deccan plateau, whereas in Bengal sugarcane was mainly produced. Then many varieties of cash crops such as oil seeds, including mustard and lentils. Then an average peasant of that time grew both commercial and subsistence crop. So that type of subsistence farming have been done at that time. Third is, describe the role played by women in agriculture production. So women performed important tasks such as spinning yarn, then embroidery, then pottery. There's a peasant woman who would skill artisan work not only in the field but even went to their employer houses and even to the market if necessary. Women played important role in agriculture production as well. They worked shoulder to shoulder with the men in the field. The man tilled and plowed the land, while the woman sowed, weeded and threshed the harvest. Agriculture production at that time was carried out with labor and resource of the entire. Then even both Hindu and Muslim women inherited zamindaris. They were free to sell or mortgage their zamindari right. In 18th century, Bengal had many women zamindar. In fact, the Rajshah zamindari, which was one of the most famous of the time, was headed by women. Next is discuss with the example the significance of monetary transaction during the period under consideration. So, the political stability provided by Mughal helped in establishing horizon trade relation with Ming, that is China, with Iran and with Turkey Empire. It led to increase in outland trade from China to Mediterranean Sea. The discovery of new land and sea routes also gave an impetus to Asia trade with Europe. As a result, enormous amount of silver entered India as payment for goods bought from India. Then Giovanni Carrari, an Italian traveler who passed through India in 1690, has written how the silver reached India from all parts of the world. From his description, we also come to know how there was an exchange of cash and goods in India in the 17th century. This benefited India as she did not have enough resource of silver. So she used for India here. Therefore, from the 16th to 18th century, there was sufficient reserves of silver in India, and the silver rupee was available readily. The mutual exchange in village took place as villagers established their links in the urban market. There were a considerable area, considerable increase in monetary transaction. In this way, villages became an important part of monetary market. Then it was due to monetary transaction became easier to pay daily wages to laborer in cash and not in kind. This resulted in an unprecedented expansion in the minting of coin and circulation of money, allowing the Mughal state to extract taxes and revenue on the cash. Then next is examine the evidence that suggests that land revenue was important for Mughal fiscal system. So, agriculture was the mainstay of economy. Land revenue collected was used to pay salaries and to meet different kind of administrative expenses. So, it was considered important to establish an administrative apparatus to ensure control over agriculture production. Thus, before fixing land revenue, Mughal state first acquired specific information about the extent of agricultural land and their produce. Land revenue collection arrangement was considered of two stage of assessment. These were Jama and Hasil. Cultivator were given the choice to pay land revenue either in cash or kind. The state preferred to collect land revenue as cash. Attempts were made to maximize profit from land revenue collection. Both cultivated and cultivable land were measured in each province to fix land revenue. According to a decree of Akbar, it was the responsibility of Malguzar to make cultivator pay land revenue in kind, and it was also kept open. Thus, it is clear from evidence that monetary transactions were very important. To continue this policy, effort by subsequent emperor like Aurangzeb continued to measure land for collection of land revenue. The next is, to what extent do you think caste was a factor in influencing social and economic relation in agrarian society? So, cultivators were divided on the basis of their caste and other caste like distinction or caste distinction. Thus, among the peasant were many who worked as agriculture laborer or worked as labor agriculture. With this, they were not allowed to live in villages. They resided outside the villages and were assigned to do menial tasks and lacked resources. Thus, they were poverty stricken. Caste distinction had also begun to permeate other communities as well. In Muslim communities, menial were like Halkoran, that is scavenger, manual scavenger. A direct relation exists between caste, poverty and social status. And in 17th century, Marwar Rajput are described with peasant and equated with Jats. They were given an inferior status in the caste hierarchy. Then caste like Ahir, Gujar and Malis reached an elevated status in the eastern region. And the pastoral and fishing caste like the Sedgops and Kavitas acquired the status of peasant. The next is, how were the life of forest dweller transformed in the 16th and 17th centuries? So this one you can write transformation in the life of forest dweller. There is a vast variety of transformation, like huge area were covered with forest in various part of India in during 16th and 17th century. Forest dweller were called jungli. The term jungli was used to describe those whose occupation included activities such as hunting, gathering of forest produce, and shifting cultivation. These activities were performed according to a specific reason in the various regions. Consider the example of bhil, who fished in summer and collected forest produce in spring. Then such activities enabled the forest tribe to be mobile, which was a characteristic feature of their life then. As the state required elephants for consolidation of mighty army, the Peshk levied on the forest people to supply of elephants. Then the life of forest dweller led to spread of commercial agriculture. Forest products like honey, beeswax, gum, and lac were in huge demand. Gum and lac became major item of overseas export in the 17th century. And on valuable foreign exchange, elephants were also captured and sold. Tribe like the Punjab Lohanis engaged in overland trade with Afghanistan and internal trade in Punjab as well. Then social factors were also responsible for transforming the life of forest dweller. Even many tribal chiefs become zamindars, some even become king. They could recruit people from their own tribe in the army. For example, in Assam, the Ahom king depended on people who rendered military services in exchange of land. Then by 16th century, the transition from a tribal to monarchical system had taken place. Then a Nine Egbury description has been mentioned about the existence of tribal kingdom in northeastern India. A description is also made regarding the king who fought and conquered a number of tribes. Then new culture influence also entered in the forested area. Probably Sufi saint played a remarkable role in spreading Islam in these area. Then examine the role played by Zamindar in Mughal India. So in this one you can say Zamindar were the people who did not directly participate in the process of agriculture production, but they enjoyed high status in the society. The Zamindar considered their land as their property, that is Malkiyat. They had control to sell, give and mortgage their property. They enjoyed many social and economic privileges because of their superior status in the society. The Zamindar belonged to the upper caste, which added to their exalted status in society. The Zamindar rendered certain services for the state. As a result of their service, they received and attained higher position in the state. Then Zamindar had the right to collect revenue on behalf of the state and also received financial compensation for their work. Then the Zamindar had kept a strict control over the military resource of the state. They kept a fortress and a well-knit armed unit comprising cavalry, artillery and infantry. The Zamindar also played a significant role in developing the agricultural land. They helped in the settlement of farmer by lending them money and agriculture instrument. It resulted in an increase in agriculture produce and sale and purchase of land by the Zamindar. There are also evidence that Zamindar held bazaars. The farmer came to these bazaars to sell their crops. If we observe social relation of village of Mughal age as a pyramid, then Zamindar were at the top. They occupy the highest position in the society. So likewise, you can say no doubt the Zamindar exploited the people, but their relation with farmer depended on their mutual togetherness and hereditary part on age. So they were able to get peasant in case of the revolt against the state. Then next is, discuss the ways in which panchayat and village headmen regulated rural society. So firstly, I will discuss what panchayat is all about. Panchayat is the village panchayat. Panchayat consisted of an assembly of elders. They represent different caste and communities except the menial class, usually important over people of the village with hereditary right over their property. Then general composition function is that in a mixed caste village, the panchayat was usually a heterogeneous body. The panchayat represented different caste and communities in the village. The village panchayat was headed by Mukwadam, also known as Mandal. He was elected with consensus of the village elder and remained in the office till he enjoyed the confidence of village elder. Then his function was to prepare village account with the help of Patwari. The main function was that ensured that caste boundary among the various community inhabiting the village were upheld. Then authority to levy fine and taxes is also give punishment like expulsion from the community. Then each jati in the village had its own jati panchayat. Jati panchayat wielded considerable power in the society. Like in Rajasthan, the jati panchayat arbitrated civil dispute between member of different caste. Then the panchayat would also regarded as the court of appeal that would ensure that state carried out its moral responsibility. For justice, petition were often made to panchayat collectively by a group of caste or community protesting against what they considered to be a morally illegitimate demand on the part of villagers. Then in case of excessive revenue demand, the panchayat often suggested a compromise. If this failed, the peasant took recourse to more drastic form of punishment, such as deserting the village. Then as usual, last is map work. So in this one, mark the area. So you should mark the area like Afghanistan, China, countries, Central and Western Asia, Italy, Portugal, France, Britain, possible route of trade that linked to Mughal Empire, like sea route via Atlantic Ocean to Cape of Good Hope, South Africa, then Arabian Sea, Indian Ocean. Then other one is Red Sea, Arabian Sea, Indian Ocean, legal route from Central Asia to Afghanistan through modern Pakistan to Kerala. These are the various routes. So I'm done with this theme, that is 8th. And next lecture we will talk about next theme, that is 9. That's all for today. Thank you.